You guys ready?
Yeah.
Right?
Amen.
You know, I know we let the Spirit move. That's a good thing.
Amen.
I don't know how far I'm gonna get into this, but I guarantee it. I'm gonna reveal some. The Spirit's gonna reveal some things to you guys. We're in the process. Let me pray. Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, it's all about you, Father, and Lord, I just take me as far as you want me to go today and stop me, Lord, when you're ready to quit.
Yeah.
And Lord, we thank you for the words that came forth today, and Lord, we thank you for the confirmations, Lord, of, you know, even with the marriage in the beginning, the mysteries, and that's where I have to go today. I got to go to a wedding, and Lord, it's just good to see, Lord, you in control and not man, because we can't do it without you, Father. This building is not ours, it's yours. And Father, we thank you for the place that you've given us to allow us to come and meet so that we can fellowship one with another and be encouraged by each other and just have more of you.
Yeah.
Have more of you.
Yeah.
So Lord, just lead us today, Father.
Yeah.
Lord, as we step into your house, Father, in Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. God's got us in a pattern right now. It's called, building. It's a series. I think this might be the first series I've ever done in my life, right?
Okay.
I don't know, series. What is that?
It's a first.
No telling where we'll be next week, though, right? We're doing a series, and then yeah, I've done that before. Look, we're going to do this, and then, hey, I thought we was going to be, you know. And I might start talking about the gifts of the Spirit, and then we're going to get into the gifts of the Spirit, and then next week, you know, I don't know where we at, but what happened to the gifts of the Spirit? Look, I just got to follow the leading of the Spirit, and whatever gift he was talking about, that's what he wanted to deal with at the time. So I thought we was going one way. That ought to, you know, that encourages me that I'm not in control of this. That's for sure.
Amen.
And but man, really, God is absolutely amazing. I mean, we started having church this morning, and before we even got started, and man, so we've been in a process or a series which is called building, you know, build it according to the pattern.
Yeah.
And the pattern that God had laid out for us in the old covenant, you know, shows us how his church means ecclesia, called out ones, and what we're supposed to look like today. What is the true church? It's not a building, you know, it's a body of believers that gather together, that you know, we use the Greek word church or whatever it is. That's our church over there, but that's actually the building. We pass in front of a lot of churches. We don't know what's inside of them unless we go in, right? So, like you guys come in this building, probably passed it before and seen it, or other people has saw it, but there's a church there. And you might get one inclination on, all right, so they're going to have some chairs, but you walked in here and you're like, you know, man, this is different. Wow, right? So today, we're going to start this process of actually entering in. We've done covered, you know, the outside. We've covered the altar, the place of sacrifice, the laver, the place where the priest washed, baptism, repentance and baptism. We've covered the sacrifice itself, which wound up turning into like amazing how, you know, the sacrifice that was placed on the altar, which was Christ. And then we talked about the door, which, you know, now, you know, and this is where Christ meets us at the door, right?
Yeah.
So everything out here is in the natural light, the natural sunlight. So you don't get any revelation out there. All the revelation and everything is when you come into the house, when you really begin to get the understanding. And, you know, there ain't too many, but there is, you know, that actually get to or press in to go in to get with Christ, to see what he has to say. Because inside of here is where Christ actually communes with you. And that's why this altar of incense, you know, I should place it up here, because it's on this side of the door. Or this would be where the door is. And when you would come in, there's three pieces in the holy place: the altar of incense, the lampstand, and the table of showbread. There's a door right here. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to walk in through this door, and I want to tell you what it is that, you know, God has showed me on this side. And, you know, I want to show you some amazing things biblically that, because unless the Holy Spirit reveals it to you, the light, well then, you know, you won't be able to see it. And when Christ was saying that he was the light of the world and all of this, he spoke in parables out loud to the people. But when the disciples came in, he revealed to them. You know, can you imagine being with Christ and, you know, in their traditions and all the things they did in their feasts and their festivals, he's telling them, you know, it's me. I'm the showbread. I'm the bread that the children ate in the wilderness. I'm, you know, the blood of the new covenant. And that's just little bitty things. The revelation that he was revealing to, you know, to just the simple. He wasn't revealing it to, you know, the TV evangelist. You know, the Pharisees and Sadducees and all of them that's on, you know, in the high up places. Man, he was revealing it to people of low esteem, to fishermen, to whosoever will, let him come. So he begins to reveal to them all of their customs and everything they did and all of this stuff. He just begins to shed light on it. And that's what we're going to do today. We're going to just open it up and I'm going to shed some light on some things. Now, we're going to enter into the holy place, okay? And as we come into the holy place, the first thing that you're going to see is the light. Because, you know, if you walk in a room and there's no light, it's darkness. You can't see anything. So the first thing that's going to happen is normally when you walk into a place, you know, light is revealed so that you can see what's in there. You can only walk in the light that's been given you, right? So the more light you have, the more you can reveal and the more you can show. So as we enter in, I'm going to show you some things that's absolutely amazing. I can walk in here into the holy place and I can describe to you and tell you about the lampstand, the seven-branched lampstand. I can tell you about the servant candle that's in the middle. It's called the Shamash, right? Which is Christ, the servant branch that fed the other ones, and what it represents and all of that. And I could tell you about the table of showbread and what was on it and, you know, just tabernacle means. And I could tell you about, you know, the altar of incense and the dimensions of it and the study of it and what it pertained to and all of that stuff. But I want to show you, you know, I want to take you into that place. It's more than we can get down to the, you know, the place being overlaid with gold. The horns, what they represent, the gold purity, power and authority, the light of the world, the olive tree, the menorah, the bread, and make all kind of connections and reveal it and show you how that's Christ and this is Christ and this is Christ. But what's more important is to tell you what happens in here. Now, the first place we get a glimpse of the holy place is from John, who wrote the book of Revelation, right? He's the first one that tells us about when he entered in. Now let me clue you in on this, because this is where, you know, Christ is going to commune with you, share things with you, you know, and clean you up on the inside. The altar and the laver is the outside, right? You know, this altar that's in here is on the inside. He wants to clean you from the inside out. So, I'm going to show you the holy place in a couple of different places in the Bible, so we can glean from what it is that Christ will talk to you about and say to you, and what's happening actually in this place. So watch this. If we go to Revelations chapter 1, all right? And I got to lay some groundwork for you guys first. We find that John, and I'm going to read, let me read this to you really quick. Revelations chapter 1. John, who is, you know, the beloved, the one that was, you know, Jesus' right hand, the one he loved, you know. I like that. John said he was the most loved, and he wrote it. It's in the book of John. He wrote it. He loved me more. Right? It's really amazing. But there was 12, there are three that stuck close, right? Peter, James, and John, but John was the beloved. Now, John himself, he is, he begins to give you the book of Revelation, or the book of revealing. So, Jesus spoke to him about, this whole book is about revealing Jesus. It's the fifth gospel. That's five gospels, right? Four, but five. Now watch this, because this is pretty amazing. And when you get into the holy place, it's like, wow, but I'm going to show you a couple of holy places. Check this out. The revelation of Jesus Christ, of the revealing of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him. Who is that? That's Jesus. That's Jesus. It's not John yet. It's Jesus. Watch this. To show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. So God gave Jesus revelation, right? And Jesus gave it to John. Check this out. Who bore record of the word of God, that John bore record of the word of God, and the testimony of Jesus Christ, that he died and rose again, and all the things that he saw. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you, and peace, from him which is, which was, and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before the throne. The seven spirits which are before the throne is a sevenfold manifestation of who God is, and it's in Isaiah 9:2. He is, you know, Yahweh, the spirit of Yahweh, the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, and the fear of the Lord, and you can look at it in Isaiah 9:2. Okay, check this out. It says, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, unto the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins with his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God the Father, to be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Now, it's amazing because John is just starting a letter to read the letter to him before we get into the letter. Now, he's just setting the text up. Now, watch this. He says, first thing, this is what he's going to do. First thing, behold, he comes with clouds. Why? Because he left with clouds, right? As he went up, so he's going to return, the angel said. And every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is and was and is to come. I, John, who are also your brother and companion in tribulation, things going on, and in the kingdom of the patience of Jesus Christ. Kingdom means king's domain. He's waiting on Christ's return. He just said he comes with clouds. He's waiting on his return. And we are in tribulation. We're going through stuff. In fact, I'm in prison right now because of the testimony of Jesus Christ, what he said, and I bear record to God's word. Right? That's what he's in prison for. So he's already experienced the altar and the laver. Y'all with me there? I showed you that a few weeks back. He says, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Okay? He says, and I heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. Now, John's on the island of Patmos. He hears the great sound of a trumpet as that's behind him. Immediately, he said, I was in the Spirit. So John is caught out of his body, and he's brought up into the holy place. How do we know that? Because what he says, watch. And he says, and I heard a great voice as a trump that was behind me, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. And what thou seest, write in a book, and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, in Ephesus, and Smyrna, and Pergamos, and Thyatira, and Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and Laodicea. So now, Jesus is telling John what he's, you know, what to do. And Jesus is going to dictate it to him, word for word. Watch this. And when he turned to see the voice which spake unto him, it says, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. Right? John is caught up into the holy place. He left his body in the Spirit. Now, he's caught up into a place where there's seven golden candlesticks. The Bible says that Jesus is the high priest after the order of Melchizedek, ever making intercession, altar of incense, for the saints. This is where he's at. This is where Jesus is. Right? First he came as a prophet, right? Then as priest. That's what he's doing right now, his priestly ministry. He's in the holy place. Then he comes as king and sits on the throne. Prophet, priest, and king. His three ministries. He says, watch this. And I turned to see the voice, verse 12, which spake to me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the candlesticks, one like the Son of Man clothed a garment down to his foot, and girt about his paps with a golden girdle. And his head and his hair were white like wool as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. And his feet was like unto fine brass, that's the altar and the laver, as if they were burned in a furnace. And his voice was the sound of many waters, that's the laver. Right? So he done went through death, burial, and resurrection. And he put his right hand, and he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun that shineth in his strength. So, check this out. Now, I want to go crazy and start branching off and explaining all this to you, but I got to stay focused, right, on what I want to show you. You have people near-death experience, they go through a tunnel, and the first thing that they come through, they all talk about a light was so bright, right? And they couldn't focus in on it. You step into the holy place, John, he can't even, the light is so bright, it takes a while for him to focus, he's in the Spirit, then he can see him, and he's in the midst of the candlestick, that's the middle, that's the Shemash. The Shemash means, hear, O Israel. That's why Jesus said, those who have ears, let them hear what the Spirit is saying. Right? He's the servant candle. And he's serving in this area right now for you and me. Right? Ever making intercession. John 17. Watch this. So now, John is describing what Jesus looks like. The only way you can describe him is by coming in. It's the only way. Don't explain Jesus to me if you haven't came in. Because the only thing you're going to tell me about is he died on the cross and he rose again. And that's okay. That's fine. It's great. But that's just the door.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen. Come on.
If that's all there is, well then that's all there is. And that's all we need, really, to be saved, right? But he says, come. There's so much more. Come in.
That's right.
Watch this. So John's in. Because he had died and rose again, and he's in prison for bearing witness of Jesus Christ. For the word of God, the old covenant, the Torah, and for the testimony of Jesus Christ, that he's the Son of God, died and rose again. That's why he's in prison.
Yep.
Right?
Right.
So now he says, and at the sound of his voice, the words was as many waters. And he had in his right hand 7 stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun that shineth in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. Let me tell you something. When the Lord comes, brother, let me tell you something. You ain't standing in his presence. You understand? Most people get that. I mean, you know, the presence gets so thick, you're on a floor. That's the truth, right? Watch this. You know, you don't walk in before a king. You understand? When you walk in and present yourself before a king in the kingdom, you don't walk in, you know, walking up to the king like this. No, you don't make eye contact with him. Your head is down, and when you get before him, you down on the ground. Right. And he'll let you know if you can get up or not.
Right.
This is a real king.
Yes.
A real king. And he's bad, son, to the bone. He's bad. And when I say bad, I mean bad in a good way. I mean awesome bad.
Yes.
Like, you just don't walk in before my king and, you know, gonna present yourself. No, it just ain't gonna happen. Man. That's why Esther, when she came before the king, fasted 3 days. It had everybody fasting, because if he wouldn't have put forth the scepter, she'd have died. That's my God. Hush, yes. He says, and I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. That's something. How the feet represent death. Right? The brazen feet. Hush, yes. I'll get off track fast. And he laid his right hand upon me. That's right standings. Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys to death, hell, and the grave. The wife just said that. Write the things which thou hast seen, and the things which are. Two things. Write the things which you've seen. I saw 7 candlesticks. And the things which are. The letters he's going to write to the 7 churches. He describes Jesus and what he looked like, and the brazen feet and all of this stuff. Watch this. The things which are, and the things which must be hereafter. Right? Watch this. The mystery of the 7 stars which thou sawest in thy right hand, and the 7 golden candlesticks. The stars are the angels of the 7 churches. Angels are messengers. And the 7 candlesticks which thou sawest are the 7 churches. Church is represented as a menorah, a lampstand. You are the light of the world, the city on the hill. Mm-hmm. Repent, lest I come and remove your candlestick. You're in darkness, absence of light. Wow. True church, be a light. Yeah. That's what we're going to get into today. So watch this. Now, for time's sake, John goes in, and I'm going to read this first one to you. You know what? I need to just read. Watch this. When John is now in this place, face bread, which is Christ, John is face to face with him. That's what this is called, the face bread. Jesus begins to speak to John and tells John, see, John, this is what I want you to tell him. He didn't tell John this while he was on the island of Patmos. John had to come into the holy place, and now John and Jesus are communing. That's what communion means, to come into union with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
To have a union with him, right? The two shall become one. Watch this. He said, write unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, write these things, saith he that holdeth the 7 stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the golden candlesticks. He is the light. He walks in the middle of those 7 candlesticks. He walks in those churches. Man. Slow down, son. Watch. Why is he walking in the middle of the churches? Well, let's see what he sees. He's in there checking them out. He says this to him. That means Jesus Yeshua, our salvation, walks in here.
Yeah.
To check us out. And when we think we everything, or whatever it is, people, oh, our church has got it all together. But watch what he says. I know thy works, verse 2:2, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not. What apostles? His apostles. The apostles of God. Right? You try them and test them to see if they really are apostles and are not. And has found them to be liars. And has borne and has patience. And you have had patience for my name's sake. And has borne and has patience. And for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee because thou left thy first love.
Wow.
Man. You know, you're accountable.
Yeah.
We are accountable to him. And he is walking amongst his body of believers to see. And he says, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent. And do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and I will remove thy candlestick out of the place, except thou repent. A church without a candlestick, a church without a light, is a church without Jesus Christ, is a dead church.
Right. Amen.
Right. Come on.
Wow. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans. Oh, you know who those guys are? I'm going to tell you.
Yeah.
Which I also hate.
Uh-oh. Yeah.
Jesus is dictating a letter. The Nicolaitans said that, and you could find out, you'll find out a little bit further down, and I think it's in Smyrna. The Nicolaitans preached greasy grace.
Yeah.
Greasy grace.
They preached once saved, always saved. And I'm not talking about churches now. They preached you can fornicate and still go to heaven.
Yeah.
They preached you can drink and do all the things you want and lie. Don't worry about it. You know, you're forgiven. Greasy grace. That was the church of the Nicolaitans. Watch this. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcometh, listen to the words. If you don't repent, I'm going to remove your candlestick.
Yeah.
I'm glad you hate the greasy grace message. But if you endure, only if you endure to the end, you'll be allowed to eat from the tree of life. Wow. Now let me tell you, I'm just repeating the words of Jesus Christ.
Right.
In fact, he goes on to tell John, if you don't repent to another church, I'll blot your name out of the Lamb's book of life.
Right.
That was the other greasy grace church. There's a communing that Jesus is communing with John. Think about, Jesus is in this place right here telling John, and John is writing these letters to the churches. You could preach whatever you want. If it doesn't line up to this and what Jesus said, man, you're in trouble.
Yeah.
You have to stand before him and give account.
Right.
Watch this. I want you to go home now that you know where John is and what this place is, and I'm going to get into it in great detail. I want you to go carefully examine the seven letters to the seven churches. Pay close attention. You know now that Jesus, John, was caught up into this holy place. He's not in the most holy. And God, Jesus, is telling him about the things which are and which was. That's all you get right here. That's it. Watch this now. The things that are is to come. Now, a lot of people preach the rapture off of Revelation chapter 4, verse 1. Immediately, go to Revelation. Watch this now. So, in this holy place, I want you to go home and I want you to read, carefully read those seven letters. After he dictates these seven letters to him, tells him what to write to him and send them to the churches, and then they're to swap them around. They're all to look at the letters. Right. Now watch this. After the seven letters, chapter 4, verse 1, next thing. After this, after what? After the seven letters, I looked, and we're going to get into this later, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. So now, you see, John is in on the island of Patmos, which is, you know, on the earth, caught up in a spirit to the holy place. The most holy place is higher, because God's throne is elevated. A throne is elevated above everything else. You see, Revelation chapter 4, verse 1 doesn't have anything to do with the rapture. It has to do with John leaving the island of Patmos, being caught up into one place. I heard a voice that once spoke to me, right? Immediately I turned and saw the lampstand, holy place. Now, God is going to show him things which is to come. Watch this, and he says, after this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. And the first voice, the one, which I heard was as it were a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show you which things must be hereafter. So now, he leaves the holy place. Go to the book of Revelations, you'll see the altar and all of this stuff in Revelations. We can get into that later. Now, he's caught up before the throne. This is the place now where God's going to show him the hereafter. Watch this. How do I know that? After this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was, it were a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show you things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set up in heaven. And one that sat upon the throne, one that sits upon the throne. Let's check him out. Let's see who sits on the throne. And he that sat upon it looked like a jasper stone and a sardine stone. And there was a rainbow round about the throne and the sight likened unto an emerald. So he's caught up. He sees a throne. The ark is a throne, right? This is the throne of God.
Right.
Where he's going to sit. It's a mercy seat, right? The cherubims are on the side. He describes the sardine stone and the jasper stone. He says, immediately I was caught up, and one that sat upon the throne looked like a jasper and a sardine. Well, the jasper stone is Benjamin's stone. And the sardine stone, the jasper stone is Reuben's stone, the firstborn. And the sardine stone is Benjamin's stone, the last. Behold, the one that sat upon the throne looked like the jasper and the sardine. He looked like the first and the last. Reuben's name means behold a son. And Benjamin's name means the son of the right hand. Behold, the one that I saw sitting upon the throne was like a jasper and a sardine. Behold the son of the right hand, was sitting on the throne.
Wow.
If you don't know the Jewish stones that's in the breastplate, you missed it.
You miss a lot.
And now, Jesus gives him this book. Now, I'm going to stop there, because that's going to be, because I want to show you now, this is, believe me, this is amazing, amazing. Now he's going to tell him, and he says him right here. He says, where is it at? Hold the doors, open up in heaven, and I'm going to show you which things must be hereafter. I want to show you the holy place here on earth. What if I can show you, I just took you in heaven and showed you the holy place in heaven, and where John saw Jesus and it was dictated to him. And I showed you the most holy place in heaven and who's sitting on the throne. The right hand means right standards. There's one God, the Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and one earthen vessel. One manifestation. He's able to, as the Trinity, where we're made up of spirit, soul, and body, we're held together until we die, and then our spirit and soul are separated from the body. Well, God just steps out of himself.
Right.
He's just one. The face we see is Christ. That's what we see. What if I can show you now the holy place on earth? That would be pretty amazing, huh? Check this out. You with me? Watch this. When the Lord started showing me this, this is new revelation, fresh revelation, the Lord just began to show me. And I'm like, in this place here is where God communes with us. This is where God begins to reveal things to us and show us things. This is where God reveals the things that I share with you. This is the place that he brings me in when he begins to reveal himself. Because that's what the word does. The Spirit won't speak of himself, but he shall speak of me, Jesus says.
Yeah. Right.
That's what the Spirit does. It reveals Jesus.
Yeah.
That's what it's all about.
Yeah.
Right? Now watch this. This is crazy amazing. The holy place here on earth, Jesus is riding into the Passover. Right? It's the triumphal entry. He rides in. He's going to die on Passover 4 days before his death. He goes to the temple because the lamb has got to be inspected at the doors, presents himself. He's inspected at the temple for 4 days. No fault is found in him because he's the perfect lamb. But right before he dies, right, that evening, he tells his disciples, two of his disciples, go to the gate and you're going to see a man carrying a water pitcher. Why was a man carrying a water pitcher? It's the waters of purification. He's carrying it on his shoulder. Follow him. Watch this. Man, he is amazing. This is like, and where he goes in, ask the good man of the house. There's none good, no, not one, only God. Where he has prepared the chamber, the upper room. Because tonight, he's going to have them all in the holy place. And he's going to start communing to them. Oh, what did you say? Oh yeah, I broke down upper room. I broke down the furnished room, the upper room, the good man, the water pitcher. Right? So now, John chapter 12. Isn't it crazy? Matthew, Mark, and Luke talk about Jesus saying, "This is my body that was broken for you." And oftentimes that you do it in remembrance of me. That's all basically Matthew tells you. A little bit more. Luke says the same thing. So does Mark. The only one that was there was Matthew and John. Luke was a disciple later, along with Mark. But they don't tell you, man, what did he say? What did he say to you in there? Well, that starts around John chapter 12 and goes all the way to his death. So, six chapters or so in the book of John where, watch this, where Matthew, Mark, and Luke only record and tell you about Jesus being a lamb and the Passover and, you know, Judas is going to betray, you know, that who, you know, all this. John doesn't focus in on none of that. Thank you. Say it loud, Cheryl.
Outside the door.
Outside the door. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are talking about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Where now John center focuses on, like what he talked about writing the book of Revelations and all the stuff he wrote, John records every word that Jesus says in the holy place. Can I take you in? So if there's a holy place on the earth, there's got to be a most holy place.
Amen.
Son. Man. So, I'm going to take you there, though. But now, I want to take you down. I want to slow down and let's see what happens there. You ready? Wow. We in for a ride, son. We read it. And unless the Spirit shows it to us, remember, John is the closest to Jesus. So if you want to know more about him, he's going to be the one. Right? You know, check this out. John chapter 12. What time is it?
10 minutes.
It's what time?
1:07.
Say again?
20
after 12. Okay.
Preach till God's done.
Preach till he's done.
Amen.
Watch this. Wow. Man. In John chapter 12, verse 12, on the next day, this is the triumphal entry. John chapter 12, right? But really for you to get a grip on it, the triumphal entry, when Jesus, at the triumphal, he came in, right? John, triumphal entry, what did he do immediately when he came in? At the triumphal entry. He went straight into the temple and did what? What did he did?
Cleaned.
He did what?
Cleaned the temple.
He cleaned it. Yes. He overturned the money change tables. Let me blow your mind. John is amazing. Flip your Bibles back. Go to John chapter 2. Let me show you where John starts. Go to John chapter 2. John, in John chapter 1, starts talking about the light. Watch this. Because if you watch, man, just amazing. In the beginning was the Word, chapter 1. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning, in Genesis. All things were made by Him, that's Jesus. Without Him, not anything was made that was made. He is giving us, it's all Him. Watch this. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. John is making a comparison to the earth being full of darkness to you and me. Earth made up of 70% water, 30% land. You're 70% water, 30% flesh. Connects the birth of the earth to connection of the birth of a newborn believer. That's what John is doing. First thing he says, he's light. Why? Because he was in the holy place. The holy place, first thing you experience, is the light. And with that light comes revealing, revelation. That's what he's doing. He starts talking about all kind of what Jesus is. And then he starts talking about the end of chapter 1, about John, who bore record that Jesus was the Messiah. Chapter 2. Now you think Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is going to give you the record account of Jesus' life in the process that he walks it out. Wrong. Wrong. Doesn't happen. Watch what John does. Immediately, John's writing this letter, and he goes to chapter 2, right after he tells you about John the Baptist, pointing out who the Messiah is. John bears record to the Lamb, who takes away the sins of the world. John 1:28, he's baptized in the Jordan, altar and laver. Immediately from there, he goes straight to a wedding on Passover, a wedding in Canaan. That gives us the time of his return. Amazing stuff. From that wedding, we go down to verse 13, chapter 2. And the Jews' Passover was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and changers of money, and overthrew the change tables. This is the end of his life.
Yeah.
Did you hear what I just said?
Yeah.
Sal, you with me? That's the end of his life. John starts off saying he's the light of the world. He is the altar and the laver, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Goes straight to him, riding in at the triumphal entry, cleansing the temple. Why? Because of what he's done, he cleanses the physical and spiritual temple. Then, and you can read it, he begins to record three Passovers. And then from John chapter 2 verse 12, he picks back up in John chapter 12 at the triumphal entry. He goes back to the triumphal entry. John chapter 12 verse 12. And Jesus rides in. Are you with me?
Yeah.
All right. Now we're going to read, because this opens up so much stuff. Watch this. It says, now before the feast of Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, I'm in chapter 13, I'm sorry, verse 1. And I want to take my time here, because from 13 on is going to give you the holy place experience. 13 on, all the way to his death. You in the holy place with John. You're in the upper room with him. And that place is the holy place. There's no shoes on in there. Take off your shoes, right? Jesus is washing feet. Watch this. Now before the feast of Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them even unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Now Judas, it's not his last name, Iscariot. It's where he's from, Iscariot. And Simon is, means hearing. Jesus knowing, verse 3, that the Father had given him all things into his hands, that he was come from God and went to God, he riseth from supper, laid aside his garments, and took a towel and girded himself. When John was in Revelations, he said, behold, I saw him, he was girded. Watch this, amazing. And after that, he had poured water into the basin. That was the pitcher of water that was being carried, the waters of purification. That's what they did. They washed. And he began to wash the disciples' feet and wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Then cometh he to Simon. Simon was last. So he started in the order. Simon was at the last end of the table. They didn't set up, you know, they was in a triclinium, a three-sided table. Let me tell you a little bit about this if you don't know, really quick. When they ate the Passover meal, they sat in a triclinium, a three-sided table. So the greatest seat in this triclinium, three sides, the greatest seat is all the way on the other side. The less seat would be where you walked into the door. And the table went this way, this way, and this way. This would be the least seat. Don't go up, lest someone greater come and he asks you to move down. Okay? So when Jesus is doing the Passover on this side of the table, the end of the table, immediately to the right would be John, because John was the best man, the one he loved. The one that Jesus is going to honor is going to be the one directly to his left. That's no good. That's Judas. Then the disciples. And then we know in the set that Peter is last, because after he washed the feet, he's finished. It says, and he came to Peter to wash his feet. Peter signifying being last. It should have been Peter, because the bucket's at the end, to wash the feet. He's the one. If you know anything about Jewish customs, that's why the water was at the door. You take off your shoes before you enter into the house, right? Because it's holy. And then the last man at the table is the least. He's to wash the feet. And that's why the church was built, you know, Peter, on the revelation that Peter gave, and that being the rock, and he had the keys that opened everything up. So watch this. Now Jesus had washed all their feet, comes to Peter, and Peter says this, Lord, you intend to wash my feet? You don't intend to wash my feet. Yay, Peter. He said, Lord, you ain't never washing my feet. He said, Peter, watch this. If I don't wash your feet, you have no part in my kingdom. Had nothing to do with a physical foot washing, not even in the least. It was the Word of God washing them. Peter said, Lord, not only my feet, but my hands and my head too. He said, no, watch this now. He said, you know, the hands and the head is clean. The only thing that needs to be washed is the feet, because the feet represent where you go, the dirt that you get on your feet from the world. He's the one, he's the water that's going to wash them. He's the Word. And Peter says, Lord, you'll never wash me. He says, well, you won't have any part in my kingdom. And then he says, look, not only my hands and my head, but my feet too. And then Jesus says something. He said, now look, he just washed Judas's feet. He's there. And then he says, you know, all of you are clean but one. It's a spiritual thing. It's all spiritual. But one of you are not clean. And then Peter saying, looks at John. John, now they didn't sit in chairs, they reclined. They laid down side like this. Jesus would have been here. Judas would have been there. Peter would have been exactly on the other end of the table, the least of the table, the greatest on this side. Peter, looking at John, said, John, who is it that's going to betray me? Who is it that's going to betray the Messiah? That's the only eyesight that they can have this contact. John resting his head back on Jesus' chest, said, "Who is it, Lord?" And he says, "It's he who I give my sop to." Who are you going to honor? Judas dips the sop, gives it to Judas, and he eats it, and Satan enters him, and he leaves. What you're going to do, do quickly. Watch this. For let it, remember, it's about your feet. The feet represent the gospel of Jesus Christ, repentance and baptism. Shoes represent the curse. You understand what, right? You put, because of the thorns and thistles on the ground, right? So that the prophecy might be fulfilled, Psalms 81:9, mine own friend, who I did eat and sup with, has turned up his heels against me. All of you clean. All of you are clean but one. That's amazing stuff. Amazing. What's happening? You get this revelation and understanding from the holy place. That's where it comes from. This is what John is explaining. Watch this. Awesome. The call is to come in. So now, this intimate part of what's happening in the holy place, you know, Jesus with his disciples, he says things like this. It's Passover. Whew. I will not drink from this cup again until I drink it with you anew in my kingdom when we're married. You think it's kind of crazy that John sticks in John chapter 2, a marriage in Canaan, and then goes directly into Christ and the Passover? The blood of the new covenant, the celebration? Wow. Man, amazing. Watch this. Man. He said, verse 5, after that he had poured water into a basin, and he began to wash the disciples' feet and wipe them with the towel. Then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter said unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? And Jesus answered and said unto him, what I do thou knowest not now. Had nothing to do with a foot washing. It had everything to do with what he was going to the cross to do. Man. You see, the holy place, he's revealing himself. He's revealing in here what he's going to do out there. Those that were out there had no idea what was happening. All they saw was a man brutally killed by the Romans and the Pharisees, calling him all kind of things. Had no idea, but they knew. He was revealing himself to them. Watch this. Peter said unto him, thou shalt never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I wash not thee not, thou hast no part with me. Simon said unto him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head too. Jesus said unto him, he that is washed needeth not save to wash his feet. Wow. But is clean every whit. And ye are clean, but not all of you. Why your feet? Your feet represent what you do every day. Repent and be baptized for remission of sins. Your feet represent you dying every single day to do what it is that God has called you to do. If your feet's not clean, you're dirty. If your feet's clean, your hands and your head's clean. They're in the holy place. He says, for he knew that he knew who should betray him. Therefore he said, ye are not all clean. So after he had washed their feet, and he had taken his garments, and was set down again, he said unto them, know ye what I have done to you? Man, let me tell you something. When I'm reading, man, right now, we are sitting in the holy place, and Jesus is speaking to you and me. Slow down and listen what he's saying. You're there, and now he's talking to you. You're in. You're not on the outside. And this is what he's saying. You and I have been given the privilege to have a glimpse of the very heart of our Savior and what he's saying. You know how many people read it and don't catch it? You're sitting in there and now he's speaking to you. You and me. Listen to what he's saying. Like it says in John 18, I'm not praying for just you. I'm praying for all those that's going to believe. This is the place of prayer. Listen to what he says. You call me Master and Lord, and you say, well, for I am so, for so am I. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. How can I wash your feet? With the word. But do it in love. Do it in love. Had nothing to do with, and we got people foot washing all over the place, everywhere in churches. That's fine. That's okay. I had my feet washed, and I've washed feet before. It feels kind of funny, right? But that isn't what he's talking about. How do you wash? First thing is, you have to been able to come in here. Because this is where you get revelation and understanding. It's not out there in that light. You can only tell people about Jesus died and rose again. Okay, how you know that? Well, you just got to believe. You got to have faith. Okay. There's more. You can know more. How? By coming face to face with him. Sitting down. That bread that we're going to eat represents you eating that word. Every time you pick your Bible up and read it, you're communing with him. You're drinking in the new covenant, the blood of the new covenant. Well, I'm not coming to your church because you don't have communion every month. Or every week. Listen, that's just a symbol. That's the real deal. If you're eating that and not eating that, well, you're just getting some bread and juice. And that bread and juice right there ain't gonna do anything. But if you're eating that, that is gonna wash you and cleanse you. Yes. And purify you. Yes. And bring you into a holy place where you're seeing him face to face. Yes. And you're letting it wash you. And then you take that and say, brother, let me show you what God showed me. Yes. Now you begin to wash him and her. And they reveal things. When I was in there, he showed me this. That's where John is. That's the heart of John. The words. Not the symbolism. Yes, he talks about the symbolism.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
John is focused in on anyone that can lay his head on your chest. Man, that's his heart. and for Jesus to reveal that to John. You don't think Jesus heard Peter ask John? Yes, he did.
Yeah.
And he wanted Peter to know. And he related it through his servant, John.
Yeah.
The same message that was related to John, to Peter, is now being related to you and me.
Amen.
And it wasn't John that was given the key. It was the least of them, all the way at the end, that had the keys that opened. Because he was the first that identified him as Christos, the anointed one, the Messiah, the Shamash, the light. And what does Peter say? Lord, it is good that we hear. Let us build three tabernacles. One for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for you. What? You want three idols now out there? Two other idols, you know, they'd be worshiping these tabernacles up and make that mountain holy? No. That isn't what it's about. What it was about was an unveiling and revealing of he began to shine like the light, brightness in his glory. They had to turn their head and look down. They couldn't bear to, couldn't see him, couldn't look at him because of the brightness of the light.
Amen.
Were they in a upper place and he's wanting to build a tabernacle?
Yep.
Oh, what was down at the bottom of that hill? And the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. And after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John up to a high mountain where he was transfigured and shone like the light. After 6 days? Yeah, because he left there and went to Passover. Man! I know I gotta stop. I'm gonna read to verse 20. Verse 10, Jesus said unto him, he that is washed needeth not to save wash his feet, but is clean every whit. For he knew who should betray him. Therefore he said, you're not all clean. So after he had washed their feet, and he had taken his garments and sat down, he said unto them, know ye what I've done? Ye call me master and Lord, and you say, well, for I am so. If I then, your Lord and master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. You know what's going on right now at this meeting in this holy place? Jesus is dealing with, after being with the disciples, been with Jesus 3.5 years now. This is the end of his life. They are arguing about who's going to be greater in the kingdom. So yeah, the posture of take the water, who's the less, and humble yourself to wash each other's feet. Right? But let me tell you something. The only way you can get into this place is through humility.
Right. Exactly.
The proud, the pride. Unless you die to self, repent and be baptized, you can never come in here. You'll never get any revelation directly from Jesus Christ. You'll just be getting the stuff that's all, you know, that people, hey, man, you've been in that mansion? What's it like? Why don't you just go in there and check it out? The call is to come. God called the children of Israel to the mountain, right? Come. God started speaking, they all ran. Moses, you tell us what he said. He says, verily, verily, I say unto you, verse 16, the servant is not greater than his Lord, nor is he that sent greater than he that sent him. If you know these things, happy are ye if you do them. I speak not of you all. I know whom I have chosen, but that the scripture might be fulfilled, he that eateth bread with me has lifted up his heel against me. Now I tell you before it come, that when it is come to pass, you may believe that I am he. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that receiveth whomsoever I send receiveth me, and he that receiveth me receiveth him that sent me. And I'm going to stop right there. Next week, I'm going to pick up from there. and just continue to go through showing light, revealing the light in this place. And after we get finished this, then I'm going to take you up to the most holy place. There is possibly three places that the most holy place is revealed. I got to look into one, but I know two for sure, which is really amazing. And we're going to get into that. So this progress and what we're going through, Passover is April the 10th. And what my wife was talking about, that honoring the Passover, is that, you know, Christ is our Passover. You know, do you have to do it to be saved? No. You know, it's something that it was fulfilled by Christ. I just told you what the bread and the wine represented, the blood of the new covenant and the word of God. But we do it in remembrance of Him. He says, and often as you do it in remembrance of Me. Today we call it communion, right? We come into union with Him. We drink of the cup and the bread, and we remember what Christ has done. But here, you know, we teach about the Passover. You know, when was the first Passover? When did the first Passover happen?
In the garden.
That's right. First Passover ever recorded, when God passed over Adam's sins and clothed him in skins. Blood sacrifice. And we honor that. We honor that Jesus died and rose again. That's the one we serve. And we do it, you know, I could teach the four cups of Passover. My wife is going to be teaching on it. She loves the feasts and festivals. And, you know, it's amazing revelation when you start finding out, you know, what it's really all about and stuff. But anyway, I think God had laid all of this out for the progression of literally where we're at right now. You know, some people call it Easter, and she said, we don't deal with that. You know, Easter is about bunny rabbits. You know, the goddess Ishtar came down and gave birth to an egg-laying rabbit. And if you don't know anything about Easter, it's the priest would sleep with the virgin women and the babies. They would every year sacrifice the babies and dip the eggs in blood, and that's where Easter come from. And I ain't got to get into all that. And that gets into the weeping for Tammuz and all of this stuff, and which is crazy. But we honor Passover. And when you really know what Passover is and what Jesus Christ has done for you, man, your life will be changed. He loves us. And so we're going to pick up from there next week. We're going to go through what John said. I encourage you, now that you know, I want you this week, I want you to read the seven letters and really close. That's the holy place. And I want you to read from chapter 13 to chapter 18 in the book of John. So Revelations chapter 2 and 3, I want you to read. And I want you to read John chapter 13 through 18 until he leaves, the room and goes into the garden. So that's what I want you, and man, focus in on it, you know, and really look at what Jesus is saying.
Read it with spiritual eyes.
Yes, read it with spiritual eyes. And then we're going to go through it and see what the Lord shows. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, Father, thank you, Lord, for your Son.
Yes.
Thank you for eyes to see and ears to hear. Thank you, Father, by your Spirit, Lord, that you reveal these things to us, Lord. This is fresh new revelation, Father, that you just showed me this whole, everything that's happening. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you're putting your church back together, your body, Lord, to dwell. And Lord, as we come through it, Lord, cleanse us, Father.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen and amen.